शर्मा, इज शी देयर?
यस सर, गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
प्लीज, गुड मॉर्निंग बेटा, प्लीज मेक द प्रेजेंटेशन.
यस सर. A very good morning to dignitaries and all the participants. Myself Divya Sharma, and my topic is resource use pattern of different crop the existing farming systems in Chamba district. Regarding the introduction, increase in human population per capita consumption is putting enormous pressure on the land resources. Rainfed agriculture also has a crucial role to play in the economy and food security of India. There have been a few studies in India that have examined the issues related to fallow lands. These find that irrigation and use of fertilizer, monsoon rainfall, and size of operational holdings are some of the factors that determine the extent of fallow lands.
Divya, okay, beta. Okay. Hey, directly come to your research methodology, conclusions, and policy implications.
Okay, sir. Sir, due to the demographic pressure in mountains is more uneven than that catches the eye, as 80% of the population lives in 25% of the total geographical area. In Chamba district, about 95.70% of cropped area is rain fed. Thus, in this challenging world, the present study seeks to identify the existing farming systems and examine the resource use pattern under different farming system in the Chamba district of Himachal Pradesh. It is the location of the study area. In Chamba district, there are four zones. Actually, in Himachal Pradesh, there are four zones. Zone 1, that is some mountain low hill subtropical zone. Zone 2, that is mid hill subhumid zone. Zone 3, that is high hills temperate wet. And zone 4, that is high hills temperate dry. And the Chamba district consists these all zones. Thus, we take Chamba district as a study area. This is the agroclimatic zones of Himachal Pradesh. These are the materials. The characterization of existing farming systems and analysis of resource use is stratified. Was employed for selecting the sample households. Four blocks, namely Bhatia, Chamba, Tisa, and Bharmor, were selected randomly for the study area. Further, five villages from each block, and total sample of 160 farmers was drawn from the selected villages through proportional allocation technique. Further, income approach was used for the identification of farming systems. Farmers who derived more than 50% income from cereals were categorized under the farming system 1, that is cereal-based farming system. Similarly, from vegetables were put under farming system 2, that is vegetable-based farming system. And third farming system was livestock-based farming system. And fourth farming system was fruit-based farming system. By plotting all the samples, it was found that in cereal-based farming system, there were 46 farmers. In case of vegetable-based farming system, there were 40 farmers. In livestock-based farming system, total farmers were 18, and in case of fruit-based farming system, 56 farmers were identified. This is the second plan of the study area. Zones were selected, then blocks were selected, then villages were selected. From this by proportion allocation method, 160 sample size was taken. Then further, this sample size was distributed under different farming systems. Regarding the result, multiple cropping index was worked out. Regarding the results, it can be seen from the table that paddy was the main cereal crop in farming system 1, accounting for 25.80% of total cropped area, followed by wheat. It was further observed that important pulse crop from the point of view of area was black gram, followed by soybean in the farming system 1. In which was the main cereal by the wheat. Among pulses, kidney beans occupied the maximum area, and tomato, cauliflower, potato, and peas were the main vegetables in the vegetable-based farming system. In livestock farming, contributed maximum area. And regarding fodder crops, clover was the main fodder crop in livestock-based farming system. And regarding pulses, kidney beans, main pulse was in the farming system 3rd. In fruit-based farming system, during winter from November to April, in farming system 4, the area of this block remained covered with snow, while in summer season remained mild. Thus, most of the crops are grown in this farming system mainly in kharif season.
Okay.
Then, Then further, cultivated land utilization index was worked out, which showed that how the land was put to use in the study area. Index was observed to be less than one. Was kept area farming system fourth due to uneven topography of the hills. But for food security, intensification is very much essential. Further, relative cropping intensity index was worked out, which indicated that in farming system one, the amount of area time allocated to paddy was maximum in farming system one. In farming system 2 and 3, wheat crop dominated, and in farming system 4, kidney beans dominated regarding the area time allocation to the crop. Thus, the further regarding the resource use pattern in crops, the negative gap was observed in existing seed use pattern for various crops ranging from 19.63 to 236.65%. This indicated that growers were using very high seed rate on their farms, fearing poor germination due to lack of the irrigation facilities. Further, in case of fertilizer application, positive gap was observed ranging from 20 to 100% in farming system 1, which indicated index was observed to the gap indicated that farmers were applying for very less fertilizer as compared to recommended doses. So there was a great scope of organic and natural farming in the study area. Regarding the crop-wise labor use pattern under different farming systems, in case of cereal, maximum labor was engaged in provided amendment for 49 man days per hectare. In kidney beans, maximum labor was used, and in potato, 144 man days were used as a labor. These crops provided the employment to the rural area of the Himachal Pradesh. These are the some policy implications. The maximum cropped area of Chamba district is rain-fed. In this context, there is a need to enhance the profitability of rain-fed crops. Therefore, farming system assume a greater importance for sound management of farm productivity, reducing environmental degradation, improve the quality of life of the resource-poor farmers, and sustainability in rain-fed regions. Cultivated land utilization index indicated that the maximum area was kept fallow in farming system 4 due to uneven topography of the hills, but for food security, intensification is very much essential. The problem of land scarcity is more acute in mountainous regions due to uneven topography pressure. There is a need to increase the cropping intensity if the scarce land resource is to be augmented. There is imminent need to proper utilization of land area and productivity of main cropping systems, employing an appropriate mix of technology and policy frameworks. Thank you.
Okay, Divya. What is the scope of cooperative farming in different farming systems which you have studied?
Sir,
what is the scope of cooperative farming?
There is a much scope in the of cooperative farming in the farming system one, that is cereal based farming system.
But you have not mentioned in your policy implication.
Okay, sir, I will take care of.
Secondly, you have mentioned about organic farming. Can we extend organic farming at all India level?
Sir, it is not possible at all India level for organic.
Why it is not possible?
Sir, it takes about 2 to 3 years to 2 to 3 years to con. We can start in a small portion, not at a whole India.
Is there any other problem from consumer side?
Yes, sir. The price of the organic produce is very high, so everyone cannot afford the price of the organic produce.
That is the point. People are not able to buy the inorganic food even at the subsidized price being supplied at through PDS system. So we need more research and development activities as far as organic farming in India is concerned. Very good paper. Thank you, Vita.
Thank you, sir.
Next paper is by Pushpinderjeet Kaur. Is she there? Pushpinderjeet Kaur.
Yes, sir. Yes. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Please make your presentation.
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone. And today, my topic of presentation is the growth of rural indebtedness in Punjab from 2002 to 2012. As far as the introduction of introductory part is concerned, Punjab has been in a sort of crisis situation since 1997. The prominent causes of the crisis in Punjab are unviability, indebtedness, and declining food gain production and productivity.
Pashpinder ji, please, directly come to the research methodology, conclusions, and policy implications.
Okay, sir.
How you have selected the area of study or the other
actually, my study is based on secondary data. Major source of data is unit level record of various rounds of NSSO survey on all India debt and investment. And as I have taken NSSO round 2005 and 2012.
Okay.
When I directly come to the research results of the study, as taking all the regions of Punjab together, we have observed that growth of debt per household was 6.28% per annum, while that of per indebted household it was 5.29% per annum. Among all these regions, the highest growth rate of per household debt was found in Western Plains, where it was growing at the rate of 9.96% per annum, and the lowest rate was restricted at 1.99% per annum in Central Plains, while the same was 5.56% per annum in the corresponding growth rate of the debt per indebted household, it has been found that to be 9.66%, 8%, and 1.11% per annum respectively in Shivalik foothills, Western Plains, and Central Plains. District-wise analysis has also been done. Cultivators and non-cultivator households were considered for the calculations and for the growth of the debt among all the regions of the Punjab. Thus, in the span of the time, among all the regions of the state, although Western Plains region had the highest growth rate of debt among all the cultivators and non-cultivators households, but the same is appearing to be negative in many districts for cultivator as well as non-cultivator households. When we come to the social group-wise growth of debt in Punjab at the constant prices at 1986 and 87, the rate of growth of debt per household and per indebted household for the period of 2002 and 2012 has been shown for each social group separately, and it has been noticed in case of OBC 45.30% per annum in case of other backward classes, and for SC the same was about 16.29%, the growth rate per year per indebted household for the SCs and OBCs over the period of time, it was 2.92% and 13.42% respectively. When we observed the growth rate in the formal and informal credit, as we have divided the formal and the sources of loan in two categories, these are formal and informal categories. And then we see that for the institutional agencies, the amount of borrowing, growth rate of amount of borrowing is showing 7.13%, and amount of loan outstanding has been shown that the 7.03% per annum. As far as the non-institutional agencies concerned, that amount of borrowings, rate of growth of amount of borrowing is calculated as 3.23% per annum, and amount of loan outstanding is 2.91% per annum. After that, when we move to growth in utilization pattern of credit, then the amount of borrowings for the farm expenditure business, growth of amount of borrowing is, in the farm business is 3.7%, 7.5%, and corresponding to the amount of loan is rate of growth of amount of loan is 7.81% per annum. As far as the capital expenditure in non-farm business is concerned, and it has been shown a negative rate of growth. And it is 6.14% in the amount rate of amount of borrowings, and the same in the 6.1% negative growth rate has been showing in the loan outstanding. And
okay, Pashpinder ji, Pashpinder ji, please come to the policy implication of your study. What are your suggestions?
Hello.
What are your suggestions to solve the problem of indebtedness in rural areas of the state?
Yes, sir. In the conclusion, I have given the suggestions that as the during the period of time, over the period of time, average value of debt has also been increases along with the growth of assets. Then. I have concluded, I want to suggest that the encouragement should be given to the subsidiary occupations or other self-employment schemes in the rural area so that rural households, instead of relying upon debt, may earn their own income to meet their productive as well as unproductive expenditures. Moreover, improvement in the access of to health at subsidized rate in rural areas is very important to curb the indebtedness, because we have observed that indebted households have to take a huge amount of loan for health expenditures. There is dire need to monitor the informal
hello
credit into the agricultural as well as non-agricultural sector of rural sectors by eliminating costly sources of money lenders by government and the financial institutions for the accurate functioning of the economy.
Very good presentation. However, there are some clarification which are needed. Now it is 2020 and you are presenting a data relating to 2002 to 12. In this year, you can update the data through some field investigation or field survey. Why you have not gone for updating your data?
Sir, actually, my work is on NSSO reports.
I do agree that your study is based on NSSO data. That relates to 2002 and 12. Now it is 2020. 8 years have passed. You are presenting your paper in 2020 after 8 years of completion of your research study. Now, during this time period, you can supplement your study through primary data collection. Okay, leave it, which you have not done. What is the difference between loan and debt? Hello?
Please repeat.
What is the difference between loan and debt?
Sir, loan is the amount which we borrow from banks or from somewhere else. Or debt, it will become debt when we do not repay the loan on appropriate amount, on appropriate
absolutely,
time.
Absolutely fine. Absolutely okay. In your policy implication or suggestions, you have not mentioned the role of land reform or MG NREGA. Land reforms, the main source of livelihood in the rural areas is land.
Yes.
Your study indicates that there are disparities as far as land distribution in the rural areas is concerned. It is only with the cultivating households. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. You have not mentioned land reforms. As far as non-landholding farm households, non-cultivator households are concerned, MG NREGA is very important, but you have not mentioned their role.
Actually, in the NSSO report, only one variable related to the MG NREGA has been given. That was only that they seek the MG NREGA scheme or not. Nothing else was there. regarding related to that.
However, I think research is supposed to go beyond the source of data. There is one term. This is very very important topic. There is one term which is over indebted. What do you mean by over indebted?
Over indebted. It means that when the amount of loan is going to accumulated year by year and it has
when you have calculated different categories, you calculated that debt burden or different categories, you might have found that in case of non-cultivator households, the amount of loan is very small. However, they are over indebted by non-cultivating households. In spite of their small amount of land, even in thousands, they are taken as over indebted households.
Okay, sir.
Why they are known as over indebted households? Hello.
Because they don't have don't have any security or
No. Their repaying capacity is nil. Their repaying capacity is nil, I think.
They are not earning anything.
They are earning something. However, their earnings are very, very poor and they are not able to pay even the interest on the amount of the loan, but to talk about repayment of loans. Very good presentation. Okay, thank you very much. Next.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
very much. Sir, Gaganpreet jehda hai, sir, unne join kar liya hai. Je tusi utte question.
Okay. Gaganpreet, have you joined again here? Hello. Gaganpreet, there are some questions for your presentation. First,
yes, sir.
How you have defined farm business income?
Sir, farm business income, which the farmer is getting by selling his crop.
No. Gentlemen, you are doing injustice with this term, farm business income. That is the value of gross output minus paid out cost.
Sir, no, it was net earnings from...
Then why you say that farm business income? You are a student of accounts and farm business income is a standard term. It is the value of gross agriculture output minus paid out cost. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Second is, what is the role of land reforms?
Hello.
To solve the problem of, what is the role of land reforms to solve the problem of economic inequalities? Hello. What is the role of land reforms in solving the problem of economic disparities? Ripinder? Hello?
Hanji, sir.
Bete, meri awaaz aa rahi hai ki nahi?
Hanji, sir, aa rahi hai, tuhaadi awaaz aa rahi hai.
Phir inu Gaganpreet nu main ta question puch rahi hai ik.
Sir, eh hega ya vich?
Gaganpreet?
Hello.
What is the role of land farms in solving the problem of economic disparities in the rural areas?
Sir, land disparities among the farmers. So by transferring the surplus land which is available in the villages, if the panchayat institutions allow the use of public land or common land to
just listen. You are suggesting that panchayati land should be given to the landless people. The government of Punjab is going to acquire 1400 acres of panchayati land near Rajpura. What you will say to our government, state government? What you will say to our state government? Our government is going to acquire 1400 acres of land near Rajpura from 5 villages.
Yes, sir.
But you will suggest from your study to state government whether they should acquire or not should not acquire?
No, the land should not be acquired. It should be given to the landless people.
So you should if highlight
this.
If
they are this, acquiring that, okay, then the compensation.
Not government is going to compensate those people. That is no solution. The government should not acquire at all the land which is meant for village development or welfare of the people, particularly the landless people.
Okay,
sir. One more question, sir. Last question. What is the role of MGNREGA to solve the problem of economic disparities in the rural areas?
Yes, sir. MGNREGA is providing just few number of days of work to the landless people, and this number of days of work should be extended from 100 to 200 or 300, and it may be helpful if it implemented at the ground level properly.
I do agree with your view that days of employment under MGNREGA should be increased from 100 to 200 or 300, or as required by the laborer. Yes. However, at present, at all India level, the days of employment are about 45 days throughout the year.
Okay,
or in many states, these are around 25 days. One more problem with MGNREGA wage rates.
Yes.
The government of India has increased the wage rate from 182 to rupees 202. However, this is less than the minimum wages faced by the government of India or the government of Punjab. But would you suggest that the days of employment should be increased from 100 to up to 300 or more than that? What about wage rates?
Yes, sir. Sir, wage should be linked with the CPI as inflation is inflation effect is
that
more.
That is the next stage. In the initial stage, at least the government should assure that the workers or the laborers working under MGNREGA would get at least the minimum wages determined by the state or the center.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Next paper, fifth paper is by Muhammad Akhtar Hussain. Is he there?
Yes, sir. Hello. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How do you do?
Yes, I'm fine, sir.
Fine. Please make your presentation.
Sure, sir.
Maximum time is 10 minutes.
Sir. I'm Akhtar Hussain, Department of Economics, Sikkim University. Going to present on the topic, flood threat on paddy and wheat farming in Indian states. One of the various forms of exogenous risk in Indian agriculture is the threat of flood, which damages substantial amount of crop annually. As per the report of National Disaster Management Authority 2012, annually on an average 15.3%, that is 48.81 million hectares, area of India is affected by flood and damaging worth rupees 5431 crore during 1953-16, as reported by Government of India 2018. Understanding whether flood affects production of paddy and wheat differently in rain-fed and irrigated agriculture can help the farmers in appropriate selection of crops in a particular season with a specific agrarian setup. The earlier studies in this direction mostly discussed about the strategies in mitigating flood and impact of threat on agriculture at farm level specific to particular state or districts. Longitudinal studies covering the hazardousness of flood threat on paddy and wheat cultivation across Indian states is absent. And to examine, the objective of the study is to examine the incidence of flood threat on paddy and wheat production, including rain-fed and irrigated agriculture. So that study is based on secondary data and for the period 1990-91 to 2016-17. The data on extent of crop area affected by flood, crop area damaged by flood was taken from Central Water Commission report in the for the year 2018, and area and production of all cereal crops, consumption of fertilizer, gross crop area, net sown area, and gross irrigated area and net irrigated area are taken from Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, Government of India. Region-wise yearly rainfall data was taken from India Meteorological Department. The selection of the study period was constrained by non-availability of consistent and reliable data beyond the period. The state where flood occurred more than one-third of the study years, that is more than 9 times there were some floods. Based on that, there are 14 states have been selected, excluding the hilly states. Wheat and paddy were selected for analyzing the incidence of flood threat on the paddy area. This table is shown the area affected by flood in Indian states, and from this data of average flood affected area for the year 1990 to 2016, it has been observed that Assam, Bihar, West Bengal and Orissa are more chronically affected by flood, and there were most of the years there were some floods in these states. The percentage of area was under paddy and wheat was 64% area, gross cropped area out of gross cropped area was under paddy, and 48% was there in Bihar, 58% in Odisha, 68% area of gross cropped area was under paddy in Tripura, and 61% in West Bengal. Wheat area was in Haryana, it was 36.67 of gross cropped area, 43.64 was Punjab, and 36.20% of gross cropped area was there in UP under wheat. So the pattern of rainfall has been shown in the diagrams, and from which it has been observed that Kerala, West Bengal, Assam, the average rainfall was maximum, whereas Haryana, Punjab and Rajasthan was least rainfall area. The agriculture, Bihar, Assam, West Bengal, Odisha are listed to be highly flood prone, which have been shown from the table, and heavy rainfall is being considered one of the causing factors in the several studies. Open access irrigational facilities may increase the post flood agricultural production was given by Banerjee 2010 in their studies. Then improving irrigation and then flood states may helpful in reducing flood threat was also given by Mishra in Bihar 2001. So average rainfall it has been shown already. And the irrigation intensity was calculated by net irrigated area by net sown area into 100. And the irrigation was in the mostly flood affected states such as Assam, Bihar, and West Bengal. It was Orissa. It was comparatively lower. However, the least flood affected states such as Punjab, Haryana was highly. Irrigation intensity was higher. The methodology, beside descriptive statistics, shear estimation technique, seemingly unrelated regression technique, was used for jointly determining the association of flood affected area with output of paddy and wheat, together with impact of annual average rainfall, irrigation infrastructure, and spread of flood across the states, Indian states, selected states. So several studies in agriculture have used the shear estimation technique.
Hussain, please listen to me.
Yes.
Sum up your conclusions and policy implications.
Sure, sir.
Sum up your conclusions and policy implications.
Sure, sir. The model.
What are your main conclusions and policy?
Yes, sir. Okay. So, from the study, it has been found that the area affected area under cultivation has found to be significant with positive elasticity across the sample states in the selected crops, suggesting that output of paddy and wheat moves with the increase in area, which is very common. However, across the states of the present study, the area affected by flood turned out to be negative, which is statistically significant in output of both the selected crops, implies that output decreased with expansion of area affected by the flood in the study location for the reference period. And the consumption of fertilizer was found to be positively elastic determinant of the crop, selected crops output, and statistically significant for the crops. The coefficient of rainfall taking cropped area affected by flood as dependent variable was found to be positive and statistically significant for both the crops, indicating that the rainfall to some extent contributed towards the occurrence of flood. Though the water is life for the growth of any plant, yet water level exceeding required level may destroy the plant growth. And while rainwater exceeding the limit may contribute to the overflow of the water from the river causing flood. Though the proper channelization of river water to the fields of agriculture, irrigation is an important agricultural infrastructure which helped in controlling flood water, but exceptionally in the estimated results suggested expansion of irrigated area was less successful in controlling flood water in the study. This may be due to the fact that most of the flood affected states are least irrigated and the intensity was least. So the present study observed and the conclusion, though the area expansion was expansion helped in attaining higher output of paddy, but the area affected by flood was negatively affected towards the output, and the excessive rainfall to some extent contributed toward the occurrence of flood, and exceptionally this irrigation happened, and the measures by government to increase the spread of irrigation through proper channelization in the rainfed and flood affected states may be helpful in effective management of overflow of river water causing flood. So that's all, sir. Thank you, sir.
Very good presentation. Thank you very much. Next paper is by Sharanjit Kaur, Mini Goyal and Lapreet Singh. Is anyone there? Hello? Hello? Next paper is by Sharanjit Kaur, Mini Goyal and Lapreet Singh.
Sir, Lapreet ko dikta rahe hai.
Dekho, yeh na jo hai, beta, koi Rupinder itte na jo hai, koi appa gaya nuh chhad di hale.
Sir, hai nahi ga, koi bhi. Ikadar
Chalo, hai. Okay.
Good morning, sir. I am Anamala Sarojas.
Please make the presentation.
Okay. Hello, sir.
Okay, beta. Make your presentation. Start, yeah.
Okay. Good morning, all. Thank you for being here. Today, I'm talking to you about paper presentation on comparative economics of the study in Anandapur district. Coming to the introduction, handloom industry is a vital sector in India. It's a growing employment mass. Nearly 8 million people are employed in the weaving industry. Andhra Pradesh has 20,000 weaving industry. The amount of the product in Andhra Pradesh. These elegant silk series and powders made of pure silk with elaborate jerry work in attractive color. 3,000 to 50,000.
Briefly say something about the introduction. Very briefly.
Yes.
And then your research methodology, main conclusions and policy implications.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. In Dharmavaram, 25,000 weavers families are totally depending on the weaving as a profession. In order to encourage such professional weavers, the Government of India has accorded geographical indication registry to Dharmavaram Pattsarees and Powders during 2014. Coming to the methodology, the study was conducted in district of
Andhra Pradesh.
Yes, sir. This is my area.
Okay.
My samples was 70. Different types of weavers. Let me explain what is the differentiation between the weavers. Independent weavers, again two types. Own business weavers, they have own business and they incur all the costs like variable cost and fixed cost. It runs on a small business by family. And another one is working under the Dhani. Dhani is a person to provide source of raw material to the who are have own looms. And he also supplies raw material and looms who are not have the looms. And finally, he collected the product from the weavers and pays them on per piece basis. And another one is the master. Master weaver is a business on a small scale by hiring on wage basis. And the weavers who are working under the master weavers, these weavers work per wage basis, and the wages depend on the number of units they produce. Coming to the primary data, types of dependent weaving units. Business structure, all the respondents of own operators, is business and so proprietorship only. And 80% of the own business weavers reasons to choose this why it is a family tradition. And 46% about there is an opportunity to earn more earnings. and followed by quick turnover could be from home and financial problems. And who are working under the Dhani, 73% of weavers, reasons for choose this one. Why? Because it is an opportunity to high profitability. And 93% of own business weavers had an passbook as compared to the 60% of the weavers. This passbook was issued by the Handloom and Textile Department of Anantapur to encourage the handloom weavers.
Okay.
Its characteristics of weaver master weaving unit. 90% of the master weavers manage business and sole proprietorship, and remaining 10% only manage their partnership. 80% of the weavers selected because it is a family tradition, and also they want to earn more earnings. 73% of weavers under the master weavers choose this profession because it's a family tradition. And 60% of the master weavers had earned passbook as compared to the 56% of the weavers under the master weaver. Coming to the nature of residency, 90% of master weavers had own houses. Weavers under the master weaver, 63% weavers had rented houses. Next, types of the dharmas and paths. Although each weaver produced both saris and power, most of the weavers produced either saris or powders, and a few weavers only produced both types. So these are the different types of saris. 35% respondent produced followed by the double side kutu, emboju, jari or beetu kalanji, attached pole, fancy kanchipattu and butt. Market demand for brocade sari is more, as it is affordable price to middle income households. And then coming to the type of power, 27% of the respondents gave lakshadipalu, followed by pattu pavada, kaljana, langavoni. Market demand for lakshadipalu was more owed by it is a private design called affordable prices. And these are the types of silk saris.
Okay.
These are different silk saris and pavadas. Economic dharma on silk weaving by independent weavers. So the average established cost of own business weavers, that is rupees, compared to working under the dhani, that is 28,000 rupees. Weavers is very why because They started weaving established earlier, during which the cost of weaving was less, and the average number of saris weave per annum more for weavers working under the dhani is 44, followed by weavers under the master weaver, followed by own business weavers. Average number of hours per annum, that is more for own business, but that is 144, followed by weavers under the master weaver and under the dhani. Why? Because independent weavers are mostly focused on powders only. Then coming to the variable cost and fixed cost, these are the different items of the variable cost: raw material cost, dyeing cost, and fixed cost are depreciation and interest on loom and rotnam, design cost, design parts.
Okay. Continue.
2 lakhs, almost 2 lakhs as compared to the who are working under the is only rupees. Why? Because Dhani only provides the raw material. So that's why the total cost varies. Earnings per day, who are working under the Dhani get more, that is rupees 400 as compared to the own business viewer, that is 57 rupees only, followed by weavers under the master weaver. Next, coming economics of the Dharmavaram silk weaving by master weaver. Since this is a piece of looms, different types of weaving units are classified into category. This is a small weaving unit, less than 10 looms, 11 looms, and greater than 30 looms. Fourth type is the work on Dhani, and fifth type is the weaver have computerized loom, pit loom. So the average establishment cost of large unit was more, almost 55 lakh rupees, as followed by master weaver cum dhani, that is 3,92,000, followed by remaining units. Okay, sorry. The average, it may be noted that from the table, the number of saris and pavadas, both the small unit and large unit, produce both types, but the remain other types of units, they produce only saris, not pavadas. Coming to the variable cost and average number of saris weaved per annum produced by large unit, that is more 2,622 per annum, followed by master weaver cum dhani, that is 2,160. Variable cost, among the different items of the variable cost, that is material cost accounted for 60-65%, and the labor wages above 30-35%, and dyeing cost is almost 1-2%. Fixed cost have different items that comprises of design cost, design parts cost, and depreciation, and interest on loom and ratnam. So the total cost of the large unit, that is more, that is almost 3.9 crores, followed by master weaver cum dhani, that is 2.1 crore, followed by remaining unit. Okay. Per day is more for large unit.
Now please sum up your results and policy implication. Sum up.
Construction of master weavers, the higher access, high cost of material, and high investment, low profit, and construction of the high cost of material has low profits and no supply. The concrete policy implication, the universe has to trial and face the market. Master weavers continuously been in the product mix to specific textile brand name values from saris to
hello
sir. Sharoja left kar gayi hai, kuch technical problem karke
mai kya technical problem la de, but hun apna next liye
chat dwara ho join kar di,
ye join kar ko theek hai, je nahi join kar di.
Hello sir.
Sir kar liya sir.
Please directly come to the policy implications.
Yes, sir. We were master employ middle nation agent who acted as trader come master weaver and the weaver. So Dharmavaram provides employment and security to large number of people. So the government can come up with attractive to prevent independent weavers and the need for sourcing of material and also switching from and looms to power the implementation of this support to handloom sector announced by the government would promote the handloom Dharmavaram handloom sector. Thank you so much for your information.
Okay, thank you. Next paper is by Ritu Rathore. Is she there?
Yes sir,
please make your presentation.
सर एक्चुअली मैं अपनी स्लाइड शेयर करना चाहती हूँ, पर समवन ही स्लाइड्स इज ऑलरेडी देयर.
देयर इज सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम सो प्लीज मेक योर प्रेजेंटेशन विद इन 10 मिनट्स. वेरी ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन, देन डायरेक्टली कम टू रिसर्च मेथडोलॉजी, दैट टू इन ब्रीफ, एंड कंसंट्रेट ऑन मेन कंक्लूजंस एंड पॉलिसी इंप्लिकेशंस. ओके बेटा.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर. Good morning, sir. Good morning. So, today, my name is Ritu Rathore from Economics Department of National Dairy Research Institute. I'm going to give presentation on topic impact of economic slowdown on Indian agriculture. For this presentation will be introduction, research methodology, result and discussion, and conclusion. Coming to the introduction part, that what is an economic slowdown? It's a situation in which GDP growth slowed down. So according to Niti Aayog, the present economic crisis is the worst crisis India is facing since independence. So it is this economic slowdown is affecting almost all the sectors of the economy, but agriculture would be affecting badly due to the high share of food in total consumer expenditure. It would affect it would adversely affect the domestic and foreign demand for agriculture food product, which in turn have adverse effect on agriculture output and agriculture prices. It can also affect public and private investment in agriculture. But all changes associated with economic slowdown were not expected to be it's not sure that all changes will be adversely affected. There may be some favorable effects also. Hence, it is necessary to study the impact of economic slowdown on Indian agriculture.
Okay. Ritu, just listen. Is your study based on primary data or it is a review article?
The secondary data. Sir, yes, sir. I'm just coming on my research methodology.
No. Secondary data.
Yes, sir.
From where you got secondary data regarding the impact of slowdown on Indian agriculture?
For that, I have selected 5 indicators that are affecting agriculture indirectly, like resource flow. Sir, I will explain that in research.
Then please explain your methodology briefly.
Okay, sir. So for that, to assess the impact on economic slowdown, so for that, I have selected 5 indicators that may be affecting Indian agriculture, like resource flow in Indian agriculture, input use in Indian agriculture, agriculture exports and imports, inflation in food and non-food products, and agrarian distress. So these 5 factors are selected from these sources from financial year 2014-15 to 2018-19.
Just a minute.
Yes, sir.
You have selected 5 indicators and your data relates to 2014 to 2018. And your topic is the impact of slowdown?
Yes, sir.
Slowdown of what?
Economic slowdown, sir.
Slowdown economy. Okay, continue. Okay, continue.
Okay, sir. So from these different sources, agriculture statistics at glance, annual report of Department of Agriculture and Economic Survey of 2017-18 and 15-16, accidental deaths and suicides in India, National Crime Records Bureau, and Ministry of Home Affairs. From these sources, I have collected data from this financial year. And then coming to the results and discussion, so I have selected 5 indicators. So I will study the impact on these 5 indicators. So coming to the resource flow and resource flow in Indian agriculture, I have selected these indicators like public investment in agriculture and private investment in agriculture and institutional credit to agriculture sector. These indicators are studied under the resource flow in Indian agriculture. The data in table shows that public investment consistently increased over the year, while private investment shows the fluctuation over the year from 2014-15 to 2017-18. Comparison of share of public and private investment as percent of GVA in agriculture shows that while share of public investment as percent of GVA in agriculture consistently increased, the share of private investment as percent of GVA in agriculture shows a fluctuating trend. So total investment, if we consider, then total investment as a percent of GVA also shows fluctuating trend over the years. This decline in total investment in agriculture can be attributed to the fall in private investment that we have already seen in data. Because falling private investment is falling? Because falling profitability from agriculture is keeping private investor away from this sector. Hence, private investors are not actively participating. Data on institutional credit advances to agriculture shows an increasing trend over the year. So this result shows that except for private investment, no adverse effect were observed on resource flow to the agriculture sector. Then coming to the second factor, input use in agriculture. So as we all know that fertilizers and certified quality seeds are important factors which determine the growth of agriculture output. Therefore, consumption of different fertilizers and their prices were considered under this factor. So trend in consumption level of fertilizer and fertilizer prices, then distribution of certified and quality seeds were observed here. Then consumption of total NPK consumption shows fluctuating trend over the years from 2014-15 to 2017-18. But if we see the fertilizer prices, then fertilizer prices are continuously falling. So there may be the reason that because of this decrease in prices, farmers are using more fertilizer or consumption increase. Consumption of fertilizer is increased. And if we see distribution of certified and quality seeds, then it is continuously increasing. Then coming to the third factor, agriculture exports and imports, which is also a major factor to consider in Indian agriculture. So during 2018-19, agriculture exports decreased substantially while imports of agriculture commodities increased. So as export is substantially decreased and imports is increasing, so this is having a badly effect on net trade of India. This result shows that economic slowdown can have adverse effect on Indian net trade. Decrease in agriculture export can also be because of this decrease in agriculture prices. Then coming to the fourth indicator, inflation in food and non-food commodities based on wholesale price index and consumer price index. Then rate of inflation in non-food commodities is decreasing from 2014-15 to 2016-17, and after that it is showing increasing trend till 2018-19. Rate of inflation in food article and in food product, it is showing also decreasing. And consumer food price index, if you see consumer results of consumer food price index, that is, it is also showing decreasing trend over the year. These data clearly indicates that over the time period, farm income and wages are falling. So it has serious implication for the economy. Is already is almost more than 50% of the total workforce depend on the agriculture sector. So low inflation also shows fall in consumption demand, which arises due to economic slowdown. So this economic slowdown can also be called as demand shock slowdown. This result shows that economic slowdown has negative effect on food prices. Then coming to last factor, changes in agrarian distress in terms of farmer society. Fifth factor was agrarian distress. This was measured in terms of farmer society, as it is considered as important indicator of agrarian distress. So data from accidental deaths in societies was collected, and result shows that the number of farmer societies declined, but this decline was observed only in case of female, but in case of male, number of societies increases in 2018. So this shows that economic slowdown has some adverse effect on agrarian distress in
India.
Hence, after showing all this result, I can conclude that though input using agriculture and institutional credit advances to agriculture sector has favorable effect, but private investment in agriculture sector reduced during economic slowdown. Besides, factors like net trade, consumer food price index, and farmer society was also adversely affected by the economic slowdown. And so it can be said that agriculture is for the study. Economic slowdown, this economic slowdown is ambient and therefore require a comprehensive measures rather than a piecemeal one to increase income and investment to revive demand.
Okay, very good presentation. Ritu, we have some clarifications.
Yes, sir.
First, do you know something about three latest ordinances relating to agriculture? Three ordinances. Very important ordinances. First relates to private markets.
Here you're talking about economic commodity act
three ordinances issued by the central government of our country
previously
this month on June 3 the cabinet committee passed these resolutions and
if you know something
about these ordinances, are these ordinances going to affect the agriculture sector, and if they are going to affect the agriculture sector, then in which direction?
I don't know about which ordinance, but you have chosen
a very important topic for presentation. Just listen.
Yes, sir.
You are supposed to know about the ordinances. Even ordinary people are knowing about the ordinances. One more thing. Our Central Minister Nitin Gadkari has made some statement on MSP. Have you heard about that?
Sir, regarding MSP, it should be 1.5 times of cost of cultivation.
No. Nitin Gadkari's statement that our MSP is more than domestic and international prices.
Yes, sir.
Have you heard about that or have you gone through that statement?
Yes, sir. I just gone through that statement, and I have read that also that it should be 1.5 times of.
No. That is a recommendation of Swaminathan.
Yes, sir.
Not Nitin Gadkari. Nitin Gadkari has pointed out that this is a burden on the economic system or the economic functioning of the country, and 2 days later on, he take a U-turn. You do not know about that. Okay. In your different aspects, public investment is on decline, and there are fluctuations in private investment.
Yes, sir.
And when there is a decline in public investment, what is your policy implication regarding the role of public investment to the state government or the central government?
Public investment can have a role in every aspect, from starting from harvesting to export. So it should be incentivized. Like if you see export in area of exports, then public investment can develop more infrastructure.
Okay. Just please, I suggest you people to go through three ordinances and Nitin Gadkari's statement. I think, sir. The government of India is going to hand over the agriculture sector to the corporations.
Yes, sir.
You should make policy implications in your revised paper. What about fertilizer prices? You have made the statement that fertilizer prices are declining.
Yes, sir.
The reality is otherwise.
The main
fertilizer being used in the agriculture is DAP.
Yes, sir.
The prices over the period of time has increased many times. Even prices of another fertilizer known as urea.
Yes, those
are also increasing. And sir, apart from fertilizer, diesel prices are increasing every day for the last about 2 weeks.
Yes, sir.
2 weeks. And you have mentioned that our imports are increasing and exports are declining. We are importing pulses. When MSP is announced for pulses, there is no procurement, then why we are importing pulses from other countries? Okay.
Sir?
Hello.
Hello.
You have mentioned that our imports of agriculture commodities are increasing and exports of agriculture commodities are declining.
Yes, sir.
The government of India has announced MSP of different pulses.
Yes,
then
sir.
Why we are importing pulses? Why the government of India is not procuring pulses at MSP from different states?
Sir, I think pulses ka production is maximum in Madhya Pradesh only, but
that is not the question.
Hmm.
When we are having pulses and farmers are selling pulses in the market, why government is not procuring at MSP?
Sir, they are not getting sufficient prices, and in
I agree. Farmers are not getting MSP prices.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Minimum support prices they are not getting. Mm-hmm. By the government is not procuring at a minimum support prices announced by that government. One thing more. You have mentioned about agrarian distress.
Yes, sir.
Why there is agrarian distress?
Major reasons of they are not getting sufficient prices. Farmers are not getting sufficient prices.
It is only regarding minimum income, because there are three sections involved in agriculture production. One is farmers. More than 85% of farmers either belong to margin farm category or small farm category. They have very small amount of the agriculture commodities to sell in the market.
Yes.
So they will not benefit from even increased minimum support prices to the extent they require. Even some farmers are there who sell their produce during the harvesting season and they buy later on from the market. And two other sections, agriculture laborers and rural artisans are there. They are selling only their labor. They have nothing to sell in the market. So there is no relevance of MSP to those people. And as far as Indian agriculture sector is concerned, you have rightly mentioned that about 50% of our agriculture force is engaged in agriculture sector, and they are getting only 14% of the national income or GDP. And if we work out in actual terms, taking into consideration the amount of black money in Indian economy, then their share comes to only 8%. When we were giving 8% to the 50% population, then and two major sections of farming community are agriculture laborers and rural artisans who sell their only labor to earn some income. They will be in some distress. So we should think seriously about agrarian distress, because agriculture is the lifeline of human beings. Okay, very good presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Next paper is by Gurmeet Singh. Is Gurmeet Singh there?
Yes, sir. Sat Sri Akal ji.
Sat Sri Akal. Gurmeet Singh, please make your presentation.
Sir, already so many things have already been discussed by you and the other presenters. Agrarian distress te main sir hun bolna already so many
nahi bol please sum up your
haan ji sir mera sir ek my paper is a type of a review paper, an overview of agrarian distress and sustainable development goals. First of all, I want to discuss according to FAO, 65% of poor people made a living through agriculture, but due to climate change, agriculture driven growth, poverty reduction and food security are at higher risk. So there are two sustainable development goals. Number one, no poverty should be there, and second is zero hunger. So as the whole global community wants to achieve 17 sustainable development goals and 169 targets by 2030, but even after 4 years of its implementation, progress is not on the right track. To eradicating hunger and food insecurity and to achieve sustainable development, agriculture is very important. No doubt, improvement in agriculture productivity has been recorded over recent decades to satisfy the food demand of the masses, but its progress comes with severe social and environmental costs, such as soil degradation, water scarcity, biodiversity loss, and high level of greenhouse gas emissions. Our natural resource base has been damaged by compromising the future fertility of the planet. Currently, 821 million people are hungry, and every third person is malnourished, and people in the world are facing food insecurity. Now, eradicating hunger and food insecurity, as well as ensuring sustainable agriculture and natural resource management, is a central pillar of the sustainable development goals. So, sir, this paper actually discussed various parts. First of all, I have discussed the sustainable development goals.
Okay.
Then I have discussed agriculture in India. It has grown a sixfold increase from 50 million tons in 1950-51 to
more than five times. Okay.
Yes, sir. Then government's response to food security is public distribution system, then targeted public distribution system, then Garmeet Singh,
you have covered a large number of variables. However, my simple, since you have mentioned in the beginning that your article is a review article, my one simple question is, what would be the impact of three ordinances of the central government on agrarian distress in India?
Yes, sir. These three ordinance basically related with Essential Commodities Ordinance 2020.
No. These are 2020. All the three are 2020. First relates to private markets. Second relates to price guarantee scheme. Third relates to Essential Commodities Act 1955.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. No. Explain what type of impact would be there on the agrarian distress?
Sir, basically.
And why?
You have already discussed that.
I have discussed. Leave that aside. No, you explain your own viewpoint. How these ordinances would affect the agriculture community, or how they would affect agrarian distress, which is already being faced by the different communities related to agriculture sector.
Yes, sir. Sir, basically, I have not gone into detail, sir, but.
You should have gone.
Yes, sir. It actually related with minimum support price, sir. Debate is going on.
Just listen. The government is denying that we have not mentioned anything about MSP. Although Nitin Gadkari had made a statement on 11th of this month regarding MSP, and on 13th, after 2 days, he had taken a U-turn. However, in the three ordinances, they have not mentioned that they are going to withdraw MSP. It is the policy implications of the three ordinances, or the interpretation of the three ordinances by different scholars, that they have come to the conclusion that the government is running from announcing MSP and procurement at those MSP, minimum support prices. What would be the impact of the three ordinances on different agrarian sections of the farming community, different sections of farming community, farmers, agriculture laborers, and rural artisans? Okay, Garmeet Singh.
Yes, sir. Most of the farmers are marginal and small farmers. Impact will be on their.
What would be the impact on marginal small farmers?
Haan ji, sir.
ਸੱਜਣਾ ਕੁਛ ਪੜਿਆ ਪੁੜਿਆ ਵੀ ਹੈ ਵੀ ਕਿ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਿ ਰਹਿ ਗਿਆ
ਨਹੀਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਰ ਆਲਰੇਡੀ ਮੈਂ ਇਹ ਚੀਜ਼ ਨੂੰ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਸਰ ਬਟ ਇਨ ਇਹਦੇ ਚ ਡਿਟੇਲ ਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਾ ਸਕੇ ਸਰ
ਡਿਟੇਲ ਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਾ ਸਕੇ ਕਿੱਥੇ ਨੂੰ ਬਿਲੋਂਗ ਕਰਦੇ ਹੋ
ਸਰ ਲੁਧਿਆਣਾ ਸਰ ਮੈਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਮਿਲਿਆ ਸਰ ਇੱਕ ਦੋ ਵਾਰੀ ਪਟਿਆਲੇ
ਚਲੋ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲਦੇ ਤਾਂ ਆਪਾਂ ਰਹਿਣਾ ਹੀ ਹੈ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਆਪਣਾ ਸਬਜੈਕਟ ਇੱਕ ਹੈ ਭਾਈਚਾਰਾ ਇੱਕ ਹੈ
ਸਰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਸੁਜੈਸ਼ਨਸ ਦਿਓ ਸਰ ਗਿਵ ਮੀ ਸਮ
ਨਹੀਂ ਕਿੱਥੇ ਪੀਏਯੂ ਕੰਮ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹੋ
ਯਾ ਸਰ ਮੈਂ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਕਾਲਜ ਸਰ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਕਾਲਜ
ਅੱਛਾ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਕਾਲਜ ਗੁਰਮੀਤ ਸਿੰਘ ਟੌਪਿਕ ਤਾਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਵਧੀਆ
ਹੈਨਾ
ਇਹ ਰਿਵਿਊ ਆਰਟੀਕਲ ਇਜ਼ ਓਕੇ ਰਿਵਿਊ ਆਰਟੀਕਲ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਮੇਰੇ ਖਿਆਲ ਚ ਤਾਂ ਉਹ ਆਪਾਂ ਇੰਟਰੋਡਕਸ਼ਨ ਦੇ ਪਾਰਟ ਤੱਕ ਸੀਮਤ ਕਰ ਲਈ ਤਾਂ ਠੀਕ ਹੈ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਸਾਡੇ ਕੋਲ ਵੈਸੇ ਡਾਟਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਅਵੇਲੇਬਲ ਹੈ ਪ੍ਰਾਇਮਰੀ ਡਾਟਾ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਕਲੈਕਟ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ ਸੈਕੰਡਰੀ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ ਤੇ ਉੱਧਰ ਨੂੰ ਆਉਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਇਕੱਲਾ ਰਿਵਿਊ ਆਰਟੀਕਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਰਿਵਿਊ ਆਰਟੀਕਲ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਜਿਵੇਂ ਹੁਣ ਕੋਵਿਡ-19 ਦਾ ਇੰਪੈਕਟ ਹੈ ਇੰਡੀਅਨ ਇਕਨੋਮੀ ਤੇ ਇਹਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਡਾਟਾ ਕਲੈਕਟ ਕਰਨਾ ਔਖਾ ਹੈ ਸਾਰੇ ਹਿੰਦੁਸਤਾਨ ਚ ਰੌਲਾ ਪਿਆ ਤਿੰਨੇ ਆਰਡੀਨੈਂਸ ਦਾ ਅੱਜ ਵਾਲਾ ਅਖਬਾਰ ਵੀ ਭਰਿਆ ਹੈ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਜੋਲ ਦਾ ਕ੍ਰਿਟਿਸਿਜ਼ਮ ਦਿੱਤਾ ਹੈ ਡਿਫਰੈਂਟ ਫਾਰਮ ਆਰਗੇਨਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨ ਨੇ ਹਨਾ ਹੋਰ ਸਾਰਾ ਇਹ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਜੋਲ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਜੋਲ ਕੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਨੇ ਤਿੰਨੇ ਆਰਡੀਨੈਂਸਸ ਬਾਰੇ ਉਹ ਦੱਸੋ ਤਾਂ
ਯੈਸ ਸਰ ਜੋਲ ਸਰ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਹਾਂਜੀ ਸਰ ਜੋਲ ਸਰ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਇਹਦੇ ਤੇ ਆ ਰਿਹਾ ਸਰ
ਕੀ ਕੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਨੇ ਉਹ
ਜੋਲ ਸਰ ਦਾ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਲੱਗਦਾ ਸਰ ਇਹ ਤੇ ਪੋਜ਼ਿਟਿਵ ਆ ਸਰ
ਨਹੀਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਪੋਜ਼ਿਟਿਵ ਪੋਜ਼ਿਟਿਵ ਭਾਵ ਕੀ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਠੀਕ ਹੋ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਕੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਨੇ ਭਲਾ ਉਹ ਹੈਲੋ
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਹਾਂਜੀ ਸਰ
ਕੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਨੇ ਹਾਂ ਦੱਸੋ ਕੀ ਕਹਿ ਰਹੇ ਨੇ
ਸਰ ਉਹੀ ਮੈਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਦੱਸ ਰਿਹਾ ਕਿ ਡਿਟੇਲ ਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੈਂ ਸਰ
ਅੱਛਾ ਉਹ ਪਤਾ ਕੀ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਹੁਣ ਸੁਣੋ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਕੋਲ ਨੇ ਕਦੇ ਮਿਲਿਆ ਉਹ ਗੱਲਬਾਤ ਕਰ ਲਓ ਉਹ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਤਿੰਨੇ ਆਰਡੀਨੈਂਸ ਦਾ ਫਾਰਮਰਸ ਲਈ ਪੋਜ਼ਿਟਿਵ ਇੰਪੈਕਟ ਹੋਊਗਾ ਜਦੋਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਪੁੱਛਿਆ ਗਿਆ ਬਈ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਮਾਰਕੀਟਿੰਗ ਬੋਰਡ ਤੇ ਉਹ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਇਹ ਦੱਸਿਆ ਕਿ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਤਾ ਮੇਰੇ ਦਾ ਇੱਕ ਸਟੂਡੈਂਟ ਹੈ ਨੀਤੀ ਆਯੋਗ ਰਮੇਸ਼ ਕੁਮਾਰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਤਾਂ ਉਹ ਦੱਸਦਾ ਹੈਨਾ ਇਹ ਰਿਸਰਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਸਟੇਟਮੈਂਟ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਦੂਜੀ ਗੱਲ ਹੈਗੀ ਜਾਂ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਮਾਰਕੀਟਿੰਗ ਬੋਰਡ ਦਾ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਪੁੱਛਿਆ ਗਿਆ ਵੀ ਉਹਦਾ ਕੀ ਬਣੂਗਾ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਉਹ ਮੇਰਾ ਕੰਸਰਨ ਨਹੀਂ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਮਾਰਕੀਟਿੰਗ ਬੋਰਡ ਦੀ ਐਨੂਅਲ ਇਨਕਮ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਪਤਾ ਹੈ ਕਿੰਨੀ ਕਾ ਤਕਰੀਬਨ
ਨੋ ਸਰ ਨੋ
ਨਾ ਪ੍ਰੋਫੈਸਰ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਫਿਰ ਤਾਂ ਹੋਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਜਦ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇੱਧਰ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦੇ ਹੋ ਚਾਰ ਕੁ ਹਜ਼ਾਰ ਕਰੋੜ ਰੁਪਏ ਦੇ ਨਜ਼ਦੀਕ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਸਾਰੀ ਰੂਰਲ ਡਿਵੈਲਪਮੈਂਟ ਲਈ ਲੱਗਦੀ ਹੈ ਰੂਰਲ ਬਾਕੀ ਲੱਖਾਂ ਦੀ ਗਿਣਤੀ 'ਚ ਉੱਥੇ ਕਰਮਚਾਰੀ ਨੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਇਨਵੋਲਵਡ ਨੇ ਹੈ ਨਾ ਹੋਰ ਇਨਫਰਾਸਟ੍ਰਕਚਰ ਹੈ ਸਾਰਾ ਚਲੋ ਠੀਕ ਹੈ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਪਰ ਅਗੇਨ ਥੋੜੇ ਨੂੰ ਉਧਰ ਨੂੰ ਉਸ ਲਾਈਨ ਤੇ
ਯੈਸ ਸਰ ਆਈ ਵਿਲ ਇੰਪਰੂਵ
ਹਾਂ ਓਕੇ ਜੀ ਓਕੇ
ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਫॉर योर ਸੁਜੈਸ਼ਨ ਸਰ ਥੈਂਕ
ਯੂ ਓਕੇ ਜੀ ਨੈਕਸਟ ਪੇਪਰ ਇਜ਼ ਬਾਈ ਅੰਕਿਤਾ ਸਾਹੂ ਇਸ ਸ਼ੀ ਦੇਅਰ ਅੰਕਿਤਾ ਸਾਹੂ ਰਪਿੰਦਰ
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਸਰ ਹੈ ਤਾਂ ਹੈ
ਸਰ ਐਮ ਆਈ ਆਡੀਬਲ
ਯਾ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਆਡੀਬਲ
ਸਟਾਰਟ ਯਰ ਪ੍ਰੈਜੈਂਟੇਸ਼ਨ
ਹੈਲੋ
ਸਰ ਕਰ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਸਟਾਰਟ
ਅੱਛਾ ਉਹ ਮੇਰੇ ਖਿਆਲ ਆ ਪੀਪੀਟੀ ਦੇ ਹੋਣਗੀਆਂ ਸਾਰਾ
ਕੁਝ ਹਾਂ ਸਰ ਸਕਰੀਨ
ਸ਼ੇਅਰ ਯਸ ਸਰ ਆਈ ਵਾਂਟ ਟੂ ਸ਼ੇਅਰ ਮਾਈ ਸਕਰੀਨ
ਨਹੀਂ ਕ੍ਰੈਡਿਟ ਐਂਡ
ਇਜ਼ ਇਟ
ਇਟ ਇਜ਼
ਵਿਜ਼ੀਬਲ
ਯਸ ਯਸ ਨਾ ਸਟਾਰਟ ਵਿਦ ਪ੍ਰੈਜੈਂਟੇਸ਼ਨ
ਯਸ ਮੈਮ ਗੁੱਡ ਆਫਟਰਨੂਨ ਆਲ
ਗੁੱਡ ਆਫਟਰਨੂਨ
ਆਈ ਐਮ ਅੰਕਿਤਾ ਸਾਹੂ my presentation is on credit and deposit growth of financial agencies under lead bank scheme in Jabalpur district of Madhya Pradesh. As we know that lead bank is the bank which act as a pace setter and consortium leader in each district of the country. In India, this scheme was established in July 1969 by Nariman committee, but in Jabalpur district it was established in 1972. Under this scheme, each lead bank survey the allotted district and develop the program and plan.
Okay. Hello. Please continue.
District. Now coming to the objective. The study was undertaken with the following objectives: to analyze the progress of banking facilities, second one is to analyze the growth of credit in Jabalpur district, and last one is to study the year wise deposit mobilization.
Your objectives are very fine. Fine. Then come to research methodology.
Yes, sir.
That and study location.
Complete within 6 to 7 minutes. Don't worry.
Okay, but okay.
The area of the study was whole of Jabalpur district of Madhya Pradesh, which comprises with 7 blocks. This study is mainly based on secondary data. The data required for this study is collected from Central Bank of India, which is served as lead bank in this district. And all the banks which I have included in this 2008 2009 to 2015-16 in the district were included in this study, and okay. The statistical tools which I have used for the analysis were absolute change, relative change, coefficient of variation, and compound growth rate. Now coming to the main result, as far as first objective concerned, to analyze the progress of banking facilities in the district. So it is found that total number of banks in the Jabalpur district remains same, for the year, but the total number of banks branches had been increased from 189 to 282. And if we focus on this pie chart, Jabalpur block had maximum number of banks and their branches compared to other blocks. And the branches had been increased from 122 to 193. And out of the seven blocks, some blocks shows negative growth like Majoli, Shepura, and Kundam. The result of deposit mobilization and supply of credit is presented in this summary table. There was 28 banks in the district. Out of them, 21 banks were comes under nationalized, 2 banks comes under cooperative, and 5 banks were comes under private banks. It is noticed that in deposit mobilization, lead bank showed highest growth rate per annum as compared to other banks. The rate was 20%, followed by nationalized bank with 18% per annum. Contribution of nationalized bank was 91%, which was highest among all. If we see total supply of credit, it had been increased with approx 33 crore rupees to 67 crore rupees, showing increasing trend. Here also contribution of nationalized bank was 79% in supply of credit, whereas cooperative contributed only 3% and private bank with only 18%. Annual growth rate was higher for the cooperative bank with approx 23%, whereas lead bank secured second position with 21% growth rate per annum. If we talk about the total agriculture credit, it is divided into two categories, direct and indirect agriculture credit. Direct includes short-term loan, whereas indirect agriculture credit includes medium and long-term. In both of the cases, cooperative bank performing well compared to other. And lead bank had poor performance in lending to agriculture. Overall, total contribution of nationalized bank in total agriculture credit was higher with 81%, and the contribution of cooperative bank in agriculture was 10.5%, and least by the private bank with only 8.5%. And nationalized bank had expanded 81 branches in the district, whereas cooperative bank had been closed one branch. And next, number of problems faced by the lead bank of Jabalpur. One of the main problem was recovery of loan and a lack of coordination between district planning authorities and banking institution operating in the district. As we know that this study is based on secondary data and data collected from the survey report of the lead bank. Hence, the validity of this study is based on these data. Now, coming to the conclusion, nationalized bank and lead bank had healthy deposit growth with 17% for nationalized and 20% for lead bank, and a lead bank had better growth of total credit, which is increased enormously. Direct agriculture credit increased by double, and indirect agriculture credit by more than 6 times from its base year. It means demand for medium and long term loan increasing, whereas lead bank showed poor performance compared to this in lending to agriculture sector, and total number of branches were increased substantially from its base year, which was good indicator of financial inclusion.
Okay, very good presentation. Thank you very much. My simple clarification is regarding the nationalization of banks in India. There was nationalization of 14 leading commercial banks in India. In which year this nationalization took place?
Hello?
Yes? In which year nationalization
Please
of 14
repeat
leading...
Please repeat your question.
In which year nationalization of 14 leading commercial banks... Hello? Do you know the
1969,
year?
1969, sir.
1969. Okay, yes. That is right. What is the impact of that nationalization on the credit advancement to the farming community?
Yes, sir.
After Hello? Nationalization.
Yes, sir.
What is the impact of that nationalization in advancing credit to the farming community?
Farmer were able to get credit easily from the bank for the agriculture and
only easy availability or something else also?
No, sir. There was problem, but
I think rate of interest was much cheaper as compared to the non-institutional agencies. One of the statements which you have made, or the point of analysis, that the performance of cooperative banks is excellent among the other banks.
Yes.
Do you have any policy implication of cooperative performance to other fields of agriculture?
Yes, sir. Member banks should provide the cooperation and every possible assistance.
No. Please listen to me. Yes, you have made the statement that the performance of cooperative banks is excellent. I do agree. Can you extend this statement in the form of implication to some other area of agriculture, such as farming on cooperative basis? There is a success story of cooperative farming by the adult laborers in rural Punjab. However, your study also indicates that our farmers should go for cooperative farming. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good paper. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Next paper is by Shilpi Kapoor. Is she there?
Yes, sir.
Please make your presentation. Maximum time is 10 minutes or less than that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Make your presentation, please.
Good afternoon to all present. Myself, Shilpi, and my research paper is on the topic drivers and comparative level of consumption expenditure and nutritional intake across social and religious groups in Punjab, empirical evidence from NSSO data. Now, okay. As we know that over the decades, there has been a downward trend in the poverty incidence based upon the expenditure measures of poverty. According to Planning Commission, the poverty rate declined from 11.95 to 7.7% in rural areas and 11.35 to 9.2% in urban areas in Punjab. Now, this impression on the discussion of poverty was taken in positive terms and being celebrated by the policymakers. However, this argument grounding the poverty reduction becomes unconvincing when it is confronted with another set of measures on the data on consumption expenditure. It is the prevalence of undernutrition, which includes the calorie intake, protein intake, and fat intake. And number of studies have been conducted on the level of consumption expenditure and nutrition intake, applying the benchmark norms of poverty lines and calorie in rural and urban areas. These startling facts were found on the high consumption expenditure with low nutrition status and the low consumption expenditure with high nutrition status. However, there is scarcity of studies on the consumption expenditure and nutrition status of social and religious groups in Punjab. So the studies which have been done on this topic, that arouse few questions which need attention of the people of different social and religious groups eating less nutrition food, even when they have more consumption expenditure in Punjab. Are the people of different social and religious groups eating more nutritious food even when they have less consumption expenditure in Punjab? So the objective of this study is to examine the monthly consumption expenditure and nutrition intake of social and religious groups in Punjab. So, and this paper also sought to identify the various factors affecting the monthly consumption expenditure and nutrition intake, including the calorie intake, protein intake, and fat intake of social and religious groups in Punjab. The factors will be helpful in identifying the range of unevenness prevailing in these social and religious groups with regard to their consumption pattern and nutrition intake for the suitable policy suggestions. Now, this study uses the unit level household consumption expenditure data of National Sample Survey for the year 2011-12. And the data was collected from 3,118 rural and urban households of Punjab. In this study, the two-stage feasible least square technique was used to determine the factors affecting the calorie intake and monthly per capita consumption expenditure. The selection of this method is made for removing the problem of heterozygosity, as some of the literature has suggested that consumption expenditure and calorie intake by different groups, they are not varied at constant rate, which violates the assumption of the residual to be constant in OLS. So the model has been estimated by using this equation where various determinants are being used. Here the descriptive statistics of the variables which were used in determining the monthly per capita consumption expenditure and nutrition intake of religion and social groups in Punjab has been presented. And it can be seen that over 50% of the households belong to Sikh religion, 45% belong to Hindus, nearly 3% were from Islam religion, and rest of the households belong to other religions, which was quite less in Punjab. And over 50% of population belong to other social group, 35% belong to SCs, 14% to other backward castes, and very low proportion of population belong to the scheduled tribes. These are the results of the two-stage feasible least square model. The detailed level of consumption expenditure of the nutrition intake across the religious groups in Punjab has been presented in Table 2, where we can see that the results revealed that there were wide variations in the MPCE and different nutrition intake of food items of various religion groups. The calorie consumption by the Sikh household was much higher than the Hindus and Islamic households. The protein intake and fat intake of Sikh households showing 80.3 and 80.15 gram respectively, followed and other religion groups respectively. Then in order to know whether there was any statistical difference between the mean of the various religion groups of MPCA and nutrition intake, the MPCA nutrition of various religion groups was compared. And it has been found that the difference of the calorie intake among the Sikh households and Hindus, Sikhs and Islam, Hindus and Islamic households was positive and statistically significant. In the case of protein intake, the difference among the Sikh and Hindus, Sikhs and Islams, Sikhs and others, Hindus and Islam household was positive, significant statistically. This showed that the Sikhs had more protein intake than their counterparts. Then the difference in the fat intake of Sikhs and Hindus, Sikhs and Islam, Sikhs and other households was positive and statistically significant. The reason behind the intake of high calorie protein and fat by the Sikh households was due to the reason that majority of the community living in the rural areas and engaged in agriculture and livestock activities, therefore they consume self-produced commodities which enhance their nutritional intake level.
Okay.
Then the level of consumption expenditure and nutritional intake across social and social groups has been presented in this table. And it can be seen that there were noticeable differences in MPCE and different nutrition intake of food items of various social groups. The consumption expenditure of general category or others was higher than their calorie intake, but consumption expenditure of ST and other backward castes, SC, was lower than that of the intake of calories. However, looking into the overall population, the results seem some different. The MPCE was less than the calorie intake of the sample households. Then the table 5 showed the difference in the MPCE of general and OPC, general and scheduled castes, OBC and scheduled caste groups was positive and statistically significant. However, the difference of the calorie intake among the general and OBC, general and scheduled caste, was positive statistically significant. In the case of mean difference of protein intake among the general and scheduled tribes, general and SC was positive statistically significant. This means that general group had more protein intake than the ST and SCs. The difference in fat intake among the general and OBC, general and SC, OBC and SC was positive and statistically significant. Then here are the key results of the two-stage feasible least square regression estimates of determinants of calorie intake and MPCE. The findings supported the expected hypothesis and showed various determinants had significant effect on calorie intake except the Sikh household. The age of the household had had a positive significant effect on calorie intake and MPCE, but age square term had negative significant effect. This means that as the age of the household head increases, the respective household enjoys more consumption expenditure and calorie intake, but quadratic form of age reduces the consumption expenditure and calorie intake. Then increase in household size increase the calorie intake of the household, but decrease their consumption expenditure significantly. Then the land possessed by the household had a positive significant effect on the calorie intake and consumption expenditure, but quadratic form of land possessed, it reduced the calorie intake and consumption expenditure as people become nigar. Due to difference in the cultural background, different religion and social groups, they had the different calorie intake and consumption expenditure. Then the results were also consistent with the literature with regard to determinants of MPCE, and all the variables significantly affect the dependent variable. The higher level of education will positively affect the MPCE and it will lead to increase in consumption expenditure of the household. But it will lead to decrease in the calorie intake of household after a certain level through affecting significantly. Now, that is the conclusion. It has been found that there is significant difference in case of nutrition intake of Sikh community. They were taking significantly high calorie protein and fat than other religious groups. There is significant difference found in MPCE across general and OBC, and MPC of general class was higher than OBC, general and scheduled caste, and MPC of general class was higher than scheduled caste by 1393. OBC and scheduled caste and MPC of OBC was higher than the scheduled caste by 510. And in case of calorie intake, there was significant difference found between general and OBC, general and scheduled caste. In case of protein intake, there was significant difference found between the general and scheduled tribes and general and scheduled caste. In case of fat intake, there was significant difference found between general and OBC, general and scheduled caste, OBC and scheduled caste. The drivers of consumption expenditure and calorie intake were examined, and it was found that all the variables significantly affect the MPCE. But in case of calorie intake, all the variables except the Sikh household were significant statistically. So there emerge a few important implications from this analysis. One is that a disconnect between the consumption expenditure and nutrition implies the need for the probe into the causes of this undernourishment and for the strategies which are designed to mitigate this problem. The strategy should focus on socially and religiously disadvantaged households that are more vulnerable to nutritional insecurity. It should focus on the groups which would have an undernourished population. The study recommends the various policies in Punjab should focus more on the development of the socially excluded subgroups and the religious groups by providing the necessary food items and enhancement of more employment prospects for the groups which are struggling behind. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very good presentation. However, there are some clarification regarding your paper. First is, what is the proportion of ST population in Punjab?
Proportion of ST population, it is quite low.
How much is the proportion?
It is 0.06.
Is there any scheduled tribe population in Punjab?
Yes, sir.
No, there is no scheduled tribe population in Punjab.
It is very, very minute, 0.006. is very, very minute.
No. The state government has changed the definition. And as far as the population falling in the ST group now comes under scheduled caste. Anyhow,
that is according to the NSSO data. So this is very, very quite minute.
No, further. You have examined this aspect relating to social groups and religious groups.
Yes, sir.
Your study will become more relevant and meaningful if you go for different economic groups among the different religious groups and social groups. Okay.
From economic point of view. Okay, sir.
Different economic groups. Different economic groups. Some people are owning means of production. Some people are hiring out their labor.
Yes,
so
sir.
Those types of economic groups would make this topic more meaningful. Very good paper. Okay, beta.
Thank you, sir.
Now the last paper is by Kalpana Kapadia. Is she there?
Hello.
Kalpana Kapadia. Is she there?
Hello.
Yes.
हाँ फिर कहो बेटे नू रुपिंदर जी तेन सुन जाए कहीं बेटे
हेलो
हेलो तुसी अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन स्टार्ट करो
हेलो
हेलो ऑडियो आ जा आ रही है
हेलो
हाँ प्लीज मेक योर प्रेजेंटेशन
आई एम ऑडिबल सर
या यू आर ऑडिबल
ओके थैंक यू सर जस्ट मिनट सर
हेलो
यस सर जस्ट मिनट
Please take maximum 10 minutes, not more than that.
Okay, sir. My name is Kalpana Kapadia. I am a PhD student, Sardar Patel University, Vallabh Vidyanagar. And I am also working Agroeconomy Research Center as a research associate. And my topic is agriculture insurance as a risk management tools comparatively performance of NAIS and PMFBY in Gujarat. My research paper mainly secondary sources and mainly were secondary and the paper made comparatively study of the previous crop insurance scheme NAIS and the present crop insurance scheme PMFBY. The purpose was to analyze the performance of PMFBY here. 2016-17 in terms of farmers coverage, premium, sum insured and claim payout efficiency and analyze how it was different from the earlier scheme. Sir, I just keep introduction and history of crop insurance in India. We know that the agriculture insurance issue were examined soon after the independence in 1947. Then after different crop insurance scheme implemented in the country over the period time, the first individual approach scheme 1978, then after pilot crop insurance scheme, comparatively crop insurance scheme, experimental crop insurance scheme, pilot coconut and plum insurance scheme, then National Agriculture Insurance Scheme, NAIS, 1990 to 2015-16, then replaced PMFBY, even modified National Agriculture Insurance Scheme also convert to PMFBY, and weather-based crop insurance scheme 2007 to continue. The first table show that the various crop insurance scheme implemented in India to 1979 to 1979.
Okay.
Table 2, the comparative statistic of the major insurance scheme of India, cumulative since inception of the dam scheme till 17 to 80, national NAIS to number of farmer covered to 1516 to 27.12 crore to PMFBY to number of farmers covered 2018 and an average 11 crore farmers covering this scheme and uh, uh, My first fear percentage of the GCA covered all crop insurance scheme in 2017-8 out of GCA of 198.36 million hectare in the country, only 51.5 million hectare were covered under the crop insurance scheme. It means 25.96% area was covered in crop insurance scheme. The coverage area was very good in the Rajasthan, Andhra Pradesh and Chhattisgarh with about 40 to 50% GCA insured under the different scheme. In few states such as MP, Odisha and Maharashtra, the coverage increased to 2017-18, while the Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra and Rajasthan, the percentage area insured decreased as compared to 2014-15. The percentage of the crop-wise area insured all crop insurance scheme, there was not much variation over the period. The area under vegetables insured in 2015-16 to 2016-17, but in 2017-18, it's decreased where the fruits have increased three times in 17-18 as compared to previous year. On an average, 25% of the area under the fruit grain and 27% of the area under fruits and vegetables were insured in 2017-18. The area under oilseed has decreased. Sugarcane area has been also decreased while it was very low coverage jute and mista. National Agriculture Insurance Scheme. The main objective is the scheme to protect the farmers against the crop losses suffered the natural calamities like drought, flood, etc.
Please come to the main conclusions.
Okay, sir.
Not each and every scheme, main conclusions.
Okay, sir.
Yes, conclusion and policy implication.
Yes, sir. Just highlight the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana.
No, that has gone. There is okay, no Pradhan Mantri Yojana.
Okay, sir. The performance of PMFBY in Gujarat to compare it to India.
The Pradhan Mantri, Pradhan Mantri scheme has been withdrawn by the central government. So please come to the main conclusions.
Okay, sir.
That is a completely failure.
Not Gujarat. My conclusion and policy implications, sir. The last percentage of insured farmer reported the crop losses but did not receive any
Just a second.
Yes,
your
sir.
First implication contradicts your statement that is not a failure in Gujarat. You are stating that, but it did not receive any
actually sir in Gujarat, like Saurashtra region, Rajkot, Jamnagar, Junagar, in the district, sir, most of the farmers to get the benefit PMFBY in
there may be some political aspect, however your study or some first policy implication contradicts your statement. So please continue.
Okay. Okay, sir. And the second, sir, crop insurance adopted by the small and number and farmers from upper social caste without more land, better education, better access for formal extension services. Second, subsidy on premium does not positive impact on insurance uptake. Insured farmers seem to take more risk in farming, reflected by their higher debt and higher input costs, particularly seed. However, we do not detect to significant impact on crop yield. There is a need to address issues such as delay in claim settlement, generating sufficient awareness in farmers about formulation and implementation of a risk reduction strategy, development and suitable crop insurance, product and effectiveness implementation strategy, and infrastructure investigation in the research and development on insurance product design in collaboration with private insurance services provide. Crop insurance covering the price risk along with the weather risk and substituting relief payment with the crop insurance instrument. Sir, actually, ये मेरा PhD का है और जब मैं field work में गई थी तब मैंने farmers से पूछा था कि generally most of the farmers did not aware the crop insurance scheme like so marginal farmer especially so small farmers.
Large farmers. Just a minute. बेटा just a minute. Very good presentation. Okay. You are continuing your research. All the best wishes. However, the central government has itself admitted that this agriculture insurance or Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana has a complete failure because the corporation, insurance corporation has got the maximum premium. And as far as the farmers are concerned, they get very less for their crop losses. Leave that aside. My only question is regarding three ordinances, and one of the ordinances relates to agriculture price insurance. Let us know something about that agriculture price insurance.
Agriculture price insurance.
The government of India has issued three agriculture ordinances on June 5 after approval of our president of country. And one of the ordinances relates to agriculture price insurance. What is that?
Sorry, sir, no idea.
Then go through the three ordinances and you will come to know about that how these three ordinances are going to badly affect or adversely affect the agriculture sector and the different sections of people engaged in agriculture production who are farmers, agriculture laborers and rural artisans. And we will meet somewhere else and then we will discuss how the government policies are affecting the different sections of farming community. Okay, all the best, beta.
No, okay, thank you,
sir. For all the participants, one paper is left by Sharanjot Kaur, Minni Goel and Lapreet Singh. Is there anyone to present the paper? Is there anyone? Ripinder? चलो हुण इफ एनी ऑफ द पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैज एनी क्वेश्चन और क्लेरिफिकेशन रिलेटेड टू समवन अदर्स प्रेजेंटेशन दे आर वेलकम एवरीवन इज वेलकम हाँ भी रुपिंदर नहीं है कहते क्वेश्चन कुछ
नहीं सर किसी का कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं है
Agriculture sector and through policy implications. They have suggested the different measures which would be helpful in solving the problems of the agriculture sector. We hope that if the governments would implement their suggestions, some of the problems would be solved. However, the permanent solution lies with the governments, that is the central government or state governments. So they should come forward to give the due to the farming community. Thank you very much. All the best. Okay, beta. Hey, Edu wale beta kar de apna galbaat. Hey, apna hona pura ho gaya hai na section.
ठीक है सर, ठीक है.